It has been a pleasure this evening to meet an old friend from a few decades ago, Reverend Donald Jones. And he has with him in his possession two very marvelous volumes, Bingham's Antiquities of the Christian Church. Bingham's two-volume work is well worth your attention, because what Bingham has done is to give us a kind of index all the literature of the early church. Just to read the table of contents is informative. Now, there are things in the early church we can disagree with. But one of the things that does stand out is this. For the early church, their faith was the area of necessity. It was not a matter of choice. This is why they were ready to die for the faith in need. We are told by Bingham that as soon as the churches were able to build, and for perhaps two centuries or more, there were no church buildings, they met in homes. The Christian church was marked by two things, a school and a library. Moreover, in recent studies of all the literature on the early church and the first building, some very remarkable things stand out. One of the interesting things is that the first churches were built on a scale of magnificence that surprises us. Too often, Protestants have the idea that the early church had to be primitive, almost like a Quaker chapel. On the contrary, they built magnificent stone churches. Why? The church was the king's palace. And therefore, the king's palace was to be blessed for beauty and for glory in terms of the Old Testament, concerning the tabernacle. It was the place from whence the very word of the King of Kings was to be proclaimed. And therefore, it should be a place befitting a king. But it was significant, too, that in those days when copies of the written Bible were not too plentiful, on either side of the sanctuary were rooms which were called law rooms, places where you could read and study the scriptures. Now, the thing that is impressive to us as we go back and read how those early Christians read scriptures is this: truth. They very often brought to the faith some of the presuppositions of their religion. Truth. They very often misinterpreted and misunderstood because they came from very alien backgrounds and out of a corrupt world of paganism. But the remarkable thing is that they felt a mandate to apply the total word of the king to every area of life and thought. If Christ the king, he must be obeyed. It was that simple. In the second volume of my Institutes of Biblical Law, which we hope we will have printed within the year, I call attention to one facet of this, abortion. the early church took a stand against abortion. Now, to remember the facts of the first century, we need to realize the first, second, third centuries were very much like our own. Different from all other centuries in that they were, like the 20th century, dominated by big cities and urban civilization. We have to come to modern times to find a comparable urban emphasis in society. Moreover, it was a time of rampant humanism. The whole character of Rome saturated with and became from humanism. The proverb of the day most common was, "Let us eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die." Paul refers to that. Abortion was commonplace. The church very early began to deal with this fact. And it was their way of differentiating between the Christian and the humanist, the Christian hating the saved immediately. A Christian can have no part of abortion. If any of the Christians had been guilty of abortion, there was a severe penalty. Among the most common was that they could not partake of the Lord's table for 7 years or 10 years or for life. Now the figures of 7 and 10 are interesting because they are numbers of fools. In effect, they were saying for life to offend. In some cases, they actually did. They did so because they said in terms of the Word of God, it is murder and the death penalty. We are not able to vote since we are not a civil order. But we want you to know what God's Word has to say on this. If you truly are repentant, you will be our sister in Christ and our brother in Christ. But you will not partake of the table. It indicates that you are living dead. But they did not stop there. Necessity, these Christians were saying, in effect, is laid upon me. Woe, if I preach not or keep not the gospel. Abortion in those days was primitive. And as a result, many children were not aborted. They came to full term. And at that time in Rome, they were taken and abandoned under the bridges for wild dogs to kill them. And at different places in each of the cities, the babies were abandoned. The early church made a practice of going around nightly and collecting those babies, passing them around to members to be reared in the faith. This is one way the early church grew so phenomenally. Now, I cite that because I'm again trying to bring home the critical difference between biblical faith and humanism. Each has a different area of necessity. Does the Christian today say, where the Word of God is concerned, necessity is laid upon me? Or does he say it to the IRS? You see, the point is very important. We can technically agree with every article of the Confession and Catechism. But if it is not a matter of necessity, and if the Word of God from beginning to end is not a necessity laid upon us, objection? Now, at times, it's very easy to be a humanist. Most of the time, in fact. Because the burdens are very light upon us then. In humanism, every man is his own God. Every man decides for himself what is good and what is evil. He approaches the world then with a smorgasbord attitude. Now, I enjoy a smorgasbord. And my wife and I, we find a good, sweet smorgasbord somewhere, delight in going, because to have every kind of food spread out before us and to be able to go up and down the table and choose, it's a real delight. But we cannot approach the Word of God in smorgasbord fashion. We cannot say, here I choose and here I do not. That God's necessity is laid upon us. I know that very early when our work began to skyrocket in its impact, we relocated because in a day of inflation we felt there had to be a place where our booth as a root dependent upon the gifts of God's people could be a better steward of us. In an urban center, inflation is quite rampant. So we moved up to Calaveras County. Most of you have no doubt heard of Mark Twain's famous story, The Jumping Frog of Calaveras County. In the heart of the old Motherlode Gold country, up in the mountains, north of the center. A very lovely setting and an area where inflation is dramatically less than in the rest of the country. Thus, we are able to make better use of the money given to us. But we also found that because of the growth of the influence of our work, we had a continual stream of students and of ministers and of people coming up there. And the first year, my wife Dorothy had served over 800 meals to ministers when I stopped counting. And at one point, he raised the question, do I have to do it? And we both sat down and thought about it. And then decided yes. It's a part of the necessity laid upon us. Now that's a very mild and simple thing. But today, men who feel necessity laid upon them, as Levi Wisner in Ohio, who went to jail for his faith, because he had a Christian school on the stage, said that he, the pastor of a small congregation, could not do so. Unless there were a law who's been to jail twice, and countless others who've been to jail, they feel necessity laid upon them. And they do not do so as they make their resistance in a spirit of disobedience, but a spirit of obedience. Of obedience to Christ as well. Now, one of the characteristic marks of lordship or sovereignty is the law-making power. He who makes the law is the sovereign or the law. And who makes our laws? Whom do we obey? Who lays necessity upon us? God in His Word or Caesar? All law is is simply enacted morality or procedures for the enactment or enforcement of morality. Every law says, thou shalt not. Every law is a moral matter. And all morality is an aspect of theology. This is why every modern state seizes this area above all else. You know that when the Puritans came here in all colonies, they had a problem. They all wanted the word of God as well. And the king said, oh no, I am your Lord. You have my law and none other. And so they had to use God's law in the jury room while honoring the king's law outside, outwardly. When John Eliot, the great missionary to the Indians in New England, began his work, Cromwell soon came to power. And John Eliot said, I will do now that which God requires of me. And he organized the Indian villages, the praying Indians, as they were called, in terms of scripture. He taught every Indian to be an elder in his home. For every 10 elders, in terms of Deuteronomy 1, there was to be an elder, or a captain, or a presbyter, or bishop over 10 elders, both in civil government among the Indians and the faithful. And over every 10, an elder over 50, an elder over 100, or an elder over 1,000, an elder over 10,000. And they were governed by the word of God. He wrote a book on that, the Christian Commonwealth. And when Charles II returned to the throne, one of his first acts was to order that all copies of that book be burned by the public hangman. It is a rare book now. We plan in about a year to reprint it. It's one of the great evidences of what the faith of our forefathers in this country was. But they saw all of life under the necessity of gospel. But today we have a different concept of necessity. A state imposed necessity. And Caesar acts lawful. But a significant development has taken place in this country since 1950. According to John Whitehead in his book, The Separation Illusion on the First Amendment, about 1952, the U.S. Supreme Court decided that Christianity and the churches were dead. It has since then proceeded very rapidly to eliminate every trace of Christianity from the United States, as after several states. But in the past few years, something that began about the same time has been shaking them up. It has been the rise of the Christian school. Now, the Christian school movement has grown to a degree that very few appreciate. No one knows how many pupils there are in the Christian school movement. No statistics are attainable. In many states, when there is a state convention of Christian schools, they have to allow people only to pass in terms of a the registration card. Because state officials try to get in to find out how many schools there are and how many children they have. State statistics about the number of children in state schools, again, are dishonest. We found that out dramatically in Southern California after Proposition 13 passed. Two school teachers in a couple of the better schools in Los Angeles went to the Herald Examiner and told reporters, "We are tired of marking as present non-existent pupils whose names have been added to the school roll for one purpose, to collect state funds." They were promptly transferred to ghetto schools. The Herald Examiner persisted with the story, and it was finally revealed that at least $3 million had been collected for non-existent pupils. Nothing was done to those schools, although the state asked that the money be refunded after the matter became so public. But multiply that across the country in your cities, and there is every reason to believe it exists across the United States, and you have an idea as to how much money is being put out for state education. $90 billion this school year. $90 billion. Announced threat. A Christian school movement controls between 15 and 30% of the children of the United States. No one knows exactly how much, but somewhere between 15 and 30%. New schools are being created every day, so that by the end of this century, according to their own prognostications, public schools will be virtually finished. On top of that, Nation's Business, in an editorial February of this year, 1980, actually said in the editorial that by the end of this decade, the public school would be a minor fact on the educational scene. The title of it was Doomsday for Public Education. We may actually have a ballot measure in California this fall to abolish the public schools. Now, just stop and think for a moment what this means. It means that, in terms of the present direction of things, by the end of this century, virtually every child in the United States will go to the school where they will be taught the Bible, taught to believe it from cover to cover. Now think what that will do for this country. Nobody knows better than the humanists what has happened, and they are quite. They feel they are under attack. One recent issue of the Humanist was dedicated to the frightening assault by Bible believers on humanism. The homosexual community in San Francisco feels threatened by us. They passed the gay rights ordinance. Sad to say, almost every church and Christian school in the San Francisco area submitted to it, which meant actually hiring homosexuals for their Christian schools. Charles McElhaney, a pastor of a little Orthodox Presbyterian church, needed an organist and advertised a school music. And got one who claimed to believe the Bible from cover to cover, and 3 weeks later he found out he was a homosexual. He fired him, and he was promptly taken to court. A couple of weeks ago, the judge ruled in favor of Charles McElhaney.
enemy is going to appeal, according to the latest work of the attorney, Rushdoony.
Now, there is an extensive homosexual press in San Francisco,
very crazy.
The end thing, by the way, with the homosexual community today is bestiality. And they openly advertise it and show pictures illustrating what they are. Charles McElhaney brought me a sheaf of these publications. And the interesting thing to which he called my attention was these people feel threatened. Threatened by what? By the believers. By the believers. Because the people who take the Word of God seriously are on the march. They feel that unless they destroy the Bible-believing community, they will be wiped out. And they're right. If we had a comparable militancy on our side as they have, and they are ready to fight for their faith, this country tomorrow would see an end to all kinds of abominations. But the issue is very real. In the past 3.5 years under the present administration, we have seen a tremendous assault on the Christian faith. The IRS has been out to destroy Christian schools and churches. Its position is, and this was sneaked into the law in 1952, a little by little, growing to churches. You cannot be a church until you apply to the IRS and they establish you. Now that's a violation of the First Amendment. The IRS says, you're not a church unless we say you are, and we approve you and declare you're tax exempt because you're a church. That's an establishment of religion. In one current case, they demanded that a church submit samples of its sermons for so many Sundays, a written sermon for each Sunday, all financial records, and so on. One Reformed congregation in Wisconsin was recently taken to court. The church that's been there for some years, with a demand that they turn over all the records. No reason given. They demand the right to investigation. At the same time, you can pick up magazines that advertise this group, the Church of Universal Rights, Church of Individual Liberty, whereby you can incorporate and become a minister. You pay $25 or $20, I don't know the exact amount, and you can become a minister, a priest, a rabbi, pay a little more, you can become a bishop or a cardinal. And you can declare your income is church income and your house is your church. You're tax exempt. The IRS supposedly went after this outfit, but they went after it in a way I've never seen them do with others. They lost the case and didn't show any enthusiasm about carrying it to a higher court. One broker friend told me that he knew 5,000 such churches in the San Diego area. Why is the IRS demanding the freedom to go after legitimate churches and not these? We are given the example of Jim Jones and the People's Church. We need legislation, people say, to prevent abuses like that. But Jim Jones had a state church. He was collecting federal and state funds. He was delivering, just in the Bay Area, 25,000 votes to the Democratic machine and getting all kinds of favors.
He could not be prosecuted for all the lawless acts that his doom squads were perpetrating upon people who tried to break with him. He was drawing aid to dependent children by breaking up families in his group and putting the children with one or two people in large dormitory cells. That's why he had all those children in Vienna. It was not until a New York magazine blew the whistle on his lawlessness that the politicians had to run for help. He was one of them. He was working, incidentally, just before the end, with Grogan, Carter, and Pell, and Castro, with two lawyers in mind. Why no prosecution of the concern? Members who are savagely beaten if they try to rebel or break away will go to law enforcement people and only have their visit reported to Germany and even as well. Obviously, the civil authorities today are not friendly to Jesus Christ. And the church. On all sides, we see a growing warfare against us. All kinds of attempts to deal with the church that are appalling. Attempts to control the church's ministry to children of Sunday school. Nursery, child care facilities during the week for working mothers in the church, and the like. Do you know that in a couple of states there have been prosecutions of churches because of their nursery, women's meetings during the midweek, mothers taking their turns caring for the children in the church nursery. That was against the child care law. They had to have a license for that. They were funded. We're trying to get a law prohibiting such interference with the church's ministry to children in California. Failed by one to come out of committee. It has been steeped into the law books in many a state to be applied when they feel the time is right. I could go down the line to cite the types of control that are needed for our churches. I mentioned in the previous hour, that of pastoral counseling. The list of this go back to Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud said that it would be useless for a scientist to try to disprove religion. As long as men feel guilt, he said, they will feel the need for a savior. Very few on Freud. Freud recognizes that at the heart of biblical faith is the doctrine of the atonement. And he said, what we must do in order to destroy the power of religion over mankind is to convert the problem of guilt from a religious problem to a medical problem. This is the meaning of a mental health movement. This is why there is an attempt today to turn the ministry into a branch of psychiatry and to compel psychiatric and psychological training and licensing. But what we have to say is that ours is the truly Catholic faith. Not only matters of guilt, but matters of education of politics, of economics, of all things under God's word and under the authority of Christ as King. The first and basic commandment of economics is, thou shalt not steal. Now we have a system of economics that is based on theft, because we have fiat money. Let's consider the meaning of that. We have fiat money, man-made money, instead of gold and silver. The Bible says, just weight and just measure shall you have. Weight in the Bible has reference. If you look at any of the older Bible dictionaries, the weight of gold and silver. The shekel is the weight of gold and weight of silver. Our $20 gold piece and our earliest gold coins didn't have a designation. They didn't say so many dollars. It was just a weight of gold. The $20 gold piece is an ounce of weight. 90% fine. At one time, our trade dollars looked at the grains of silver by weight. That was the term of Scripture. The Constitution says that not that the federal government has the right to print money, no, it was against paper to coin money and establish the weight thereof. Now, the Vulgate Bible, the Latin Bible, in Genesis 1 uses the word fiat again and again. Fiat looks, let there be light. So fiat means let there be. The word fiat therefore means creation by a sovereign act out of nothing. Now, what we have today are fiat laws, fiat money, fiat everything. Because humanism says the state is God walking on earth. And the state need not be bound by God's laws and do as it pleases. Hence, of necessity, the state is going to issue its own fiat. And as a result, we have inflation. A paper money that is continually expanded by the printing presses, so it becomes worth less and less. And laws that are not a part of God's creation ordinances have no relationship to reality. Today, every year, you have a large bookcase full of new federal regulations and laws, state regulations and laws, and county regulations and laws. You would need a building larger than this to house just the laws that are current in the United States today. Ignorance of the law is inescapable today. And the laws of the state have no real relationship to your being and mine. But God's laws are knowable by every man. And they're right here in one book. So given, so that even one may read and understand. And so today, humanism has a fiat regime. It has no authority except its own. It specifically exempts itself from the authority of God and His Word. The very beginning of the 50s, the The U.S. Supreme Court made it clear under Vincent, then Chief Justice, that there was no word beyond the court. The human law of the court perishes beyond the world. And in every area of our life today, we have this insistence on the humanistic fiat. And of course, the essence of modernism is submit to this humanistic fiat. To say it is the word of man and the needs of man that must lay necessity upon us. What governs legislation today and human action generally? Human need. So that Congress says, as it looks at the human situation, necessity is laid upon us to do so and so. The necessity is man-made and man-ordained. Not until we return to the divine fiat and can say necessity is laid upon me by the Lord, as we return to the face of our fathers. Remember this, we can, and I believe must have, separation of church and state. But we can never have separation of religion and state. The state and the school, the family, the vocation, the arts and the sciences, all have an obligation to be under the law, just as much as the church. Now that's what Chalcedonism is about. And that's what the Bible is about. It says there is a necessity laid upon us not only in the church, but in every area of life, by God and His Word. That we must give heed to that necessity so that we might be indeed faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. I said in the previous hour, we are at war. But when we go to war with Christ our King, we cannot lose. If we go to war with Saul's arm, and have given, we are sure of defeat. If we go to war in terms of the uncompromising Word of God, he said. I like the episode that occurred in New Hampshire when one pastor was on trial and he was told that he opened his Christian school. On the first day of September, the school was scheduled. They would arrest him and take him to jail. The Reverend Roy Thompson, a Baptist in Cleveland, flew in to his aid and told him, Joe, will you turn things over to me? Because I'll open it the second day and I'll find men to open it every day thereafter. And he said, fine. So he called up one pastor after another throughout New England, said, Joe is scheduled to go to jail on day one. I'm going to jail because I'm going to reopen the school on day two. Now, he wanted to be number three. And he had ministers for 60 successive school days. So then he walked to the local paper, the state capital in New Hampshire, and he said, the city is about to send 60 preachers to jail. And here is the list of their names. Well, the state took them to court, but it backed off on sending them to jail. It convicted them, but on appeal to the state Supreme Court, they won. But in the process, Governor Melvin Thompson called in Roy Thompson and Attorney Gibbs and said, "This is a city matter and I have no say-so here." He said, "I've certainly been getting a lot of phone calls, including one from the governor of Maine who wants to know why I'm going to send his minister to jail." And said, "I want to tell you something. We've had no problems with the nuclear protesters here because we knew one thing. That they were ready to make a big show, a tremendous demonstration by the thousands, as long as they were on the television camera. But the minute they went to jail and the matter was no longer a front page story and not on the television news, they were ready to sign anything and go home. We knew that. And so we passed that. It's just a question of waiting them out." But he said the humanist today cannot cope with the universe. They will crumble. And if you men are ready to stand your grounds and go to jail and stay there because it is your belief, here I stand and I can do no other, you're going to win. But it's not going to be easy. I believe he was right. And I know, because I've been in and out of these courtrooms across the country as a witness, that there's nothing that frightens these humanists more than these Christians. These judges have been alarmed themselves. Humanists to the core. They have given one godless decision after another in the war against these courts, except on rare occasions when the sensational overthrow. And suddenly something different is happening. They have a crowded courtroom of praying Christians. The hallways are full of praying people. The steps of the courthouse are covered with Christians who are singing hymns. And there are buses parked up and down the street. Church buses and Christian school buses with banners on the side saying, "Jesus is Lord." And the judges are very nervous and jittery. They don't want to be in the public eye that way. They're not used to being faced with such conviction. Find it most distressing. We are told in Scripture that this is the victory which overcomes the world, even our faith, and overcomes the shadow. That we can say with the saints of old necessity as they are, "Woe be it unto me if I preach not the gospel and stand in terms of the gospel." If we see it all times, our judge, not as the local court, nor the IRS, nor Jimmy Carter, but one who is Lord over them as well as us, even Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy grace and mercy has called us to be thy people, and has given us such great and glorious prospects in thy word. Give us faith to stand and to give a good witness. To set forth God's claim, King of kings and Lord of lords, before kings and governors, and to know that thou wilt give us the word to speak in thy appointed time. thank thee that they have made a good intention, have separated themselves from unbelief, have committed themselves under thy word and thy sovereign rule. Bless them, prosper them, we beseech thee. Protect them by thy grace and cause thy face to shine upon them.